Are you sitting comfortably? Then we'll begin. I know some of you are new here, and it's your first visit, and you don't know so much about Martinus, so it might be worth saying a few words about him. This is Martinus at the age of 30 in 1921, shortly after he had the spiritual experience that enabled him to see the spiritual laws and principles behind the entire physical world. He borrowed a book on meditation. He didn't get very far with it. The book suggested that one meditated on the idea of God, which he did, and this whole new world opened up to him. And he describes in various places that this figure of Christ appeared and got larger and larger and eventually sort of entered his body and opened talent kernels within his consciousness for cosmic consciousness. And this enabled him from that day on to see eternity, infinity in everything, in everyone. It enabled him to see that everything is God. We are all part of the same consciousness, the same organism, and the fact that we experience ourselves as individuals, as separate, then that's an illusion. We are actually one. You can read more about his experience in the preface to Leavitt's Bow 1 and the little book on the birth of my mission, both of which are in English. So, the subject for today is the idea of food. The idea of food was a book Martinus wrote very early on in his career. For those who are completely new, I can say that Martinus's production, his entire production, is known as the Third Testament. That was an impulse he got at the end of his life in 1980. Leavitt's Bow, the Book of Life, was reprinted, and Martinus decided it had to have the title, the Third Testament, and that would be the title for his collected works. So his collected works comprise Leavitt's Bow, the Book of Life, 3,000 pages. So what are you waiting for? And the Eternal World Picture. There were three volumes published in his lifetime and three volumes published posthumously. And then there are 28 small books, about 200 articles, and lots of lectures which are gradually being transcribed and being published as articles which we can then translate. So there's a lot of material. But this book, The Idea of Food, was very early on. In 1932, he published Leavitt's Bow, Volume 1. And then in 1933, he published The Idea of Food in Danish in the magazine Cosmos. And it was quickly followed by the book called Bisættelse in Danish. We don't have a good title for it in English yet, and it's not translated, but it's about funerals. It's about what you do with your dead body after death, how you deal with the corpse. But it's about a lot more than that, so it's not just something you should read on your deathbed. It's it's really about how your thinking influences your health, how angry thoughts affect your microcosmos like natural forces, like natural catastrophes. It's about how laughter and smiling and happy thoughts create sunshine and health in your entire microcosmos. So these two books, The Idea of Food and On Funerals, were very early on, and this is because this whole area of love to one's microcosmos is a new impulse. It's a new thing that came with Martinus. Like the Christian religion and the various other humane religions have taught that we must love our neighbor as ourselves, but that love has been limited to other human beings. not even the animals or plants. And Martinus has expanded this idea of neighborly love to include the animals and plants, but also to include the microcosmos within us. So these are two very major works on the microcosmos. And The Ideal Food is a rather small book, but it's it has a very large content. It's not exactly an easy book either. So just to talk about myself for a minute, my own interest in food. I come from Scotland, and I was brought up in a family with four children. And my brother, my elder brother, went to school in the north of Scotland at one point. And my mother and my brother and sister and I went up to visit him. And we never ate in restaurants. We didn't have that kind of money, but we were out of town, so there was nothing else to do. So my mother took us to a restaurant, and she thought she would give us the best she could. So she bought us these big, bloody steaks. And I got this big piece of meat on my plate, and I looked at it, and it was bleeding. And for the first time, I realized, there's a cow on my plate. And I started howling. I cried and cried and cried in this restaurant. My mother thought it was so embarrassing. And I couldn't eat it. There was no way I could eat it. I saw in my mind's eye a cow with a big slice missing from its side. So I got really, really upset, because up to that point I hadn't associated meat with anything living, really. She got really angry, and I couldn't eat it. She had wasted our money and all that. And I didn't want to eat meat after that, but she said, you will die if you don't eat meat. You have to eat meat. And of course, that's a superstition, according to Martinus, a superstition that a lot of people have, that you will die if you don't eat meat. So the only way she could get me to eat it was to cook it so that it fell apart by itself. So you didn't need to use a knife or fork. It just had to be totally pre-digested in the pot before I could eat it. And then when I was 20, I moved to London and started studying at music college. And there was a wonderful vegetarian restaurant beside the music college. And on my second day in London, I became a vegetarian, because I discovered that... Well, I went to lunch there with some other students and one of the professors, and they were all vegetarians. And I asked one of the girls, why are you a vegetarian? She said, because I don't like eating corpses. I thought, okay, now I'm finished. And this restaurant was really wonderful, because it made a lot of effort to help people be healthy vegetarians. So it had posters up saying, if you eat this dish for lunch, you need to supplement with this and this and this for dinner, and so on. So it was a very good place to learn to be a vegetarian. So I became a vegetarian at that point. But my mother was very afraid that I would die from it. And at that point, very shortly after that, I read an old translation of The Ideal Food. And I felt very, very supported by that book. And that's why I want to share the information from this book with you. I've even met a dietitian in Copenhagen just last year who said, I told her I wanted to live as a vegan. And she said, yeah, so you want to commit suicide? She's a dietitian who's employed by the municipality to advise heart patients, diabetes patients, and so on. So, you know, it's that superstition that you need to eat meat in order to survive is still very common. So, but the evidence for the opposite is becoming very compelling and pretty massive. So I think it won't be long before that idea has completely disappeared. So... So I want to show you the evolution of human nutrition in a larger context. I want to show you the bigger picture, so to speak. This is Martinus's main symbol, and it has three titles: the eternal world picture, the living being two, the eternal Godhead, and the eternal sons of God. It can be seen in many ways. If we see it as one living being, it could be you, it could be me, we have what we call an I, and it's not this kind of I, it's the I as in I am, or I am hungry, I am full, I'm happy, I'm sad. It's that kind of I. It's this core, innermost core of our being. And we have a creative ability, which is this purple color around the edge. And then we have an organism and a consciousness, which is this colored area. And that consists of various energies. We have some memory. We have some instinct, which Martinus says has everything to do with automatic functioning. We have some gravity, which is a very odd word for that energy. It has everything to do with aggression, explosion. In the digestive sense, then it has to do, it's the force that breaks down our food. So it's not just negative, we need some force to break things down. In the physical sense too, it's heat. And it lies behind the creation of physical organisms. We have some feeling, and in this case he means humane feeling. And the humane feeling is in essence cold, which can seem very odd, because coldness can temper the heat of the energy of gravity. So if you think of the difference between a slap on the face and a caress, it's the amount of feeling. So if it's a slap on the face, there's a lot of gravity. If it's a caress, there's a lot of feeling. So, but basically the same movement, it's just a different combination of energy. We have some intelligence, and we have some intuition. So these are, according to Martinus, the six energies in our consciousness. That's how our consciousness is made up. It's also how a cow's consciousness is made up, a pig, a fish, a plant, and so on. But the combination, the quantities of these energies differ. If we now look at the symbol as the eternal Godhead and the eternal sons of God, or the eternal world picture, we can see this symbol as a symbol of the entire universe, the whole cosmos, in which we all live and move our being, as it says in the Bible. So here we see this, the eye of this universe. The purple bit is the creative ability of the universe and its ability to experience life. And the colored area is the organism and consciousness of the universe. And here we see lots of little circles, and they symbolize the living beings within this unified organism which constitutes the entire universe. And we see here how we interact with this universe. We see that the universe is sending out energies towards us, and we are sending out energies towards the universe. And the meeting between these two energies makes up our experience of life. And I'll go more into that in my lecture next Sunday. So one of the things we see in this evolution, we see an evolution, our evolution takes place within this universe. We see an evolution from the mineral kingdom to the plant kingdom, to the animal kingdom, to the terrestrial human part of the animal kingdom, to what Martinus calls the real human kingdom. And this evolution covers various forms of nutrition. We see an evolution of nutrition here. We see the forms of nutrition we see in the plant kingdom, which I'll come back to. And this is completely non-violent. And we see an evolution towards very violent forms of nutrition where killing is the basis for it, killing other animals. And then we see an evolution towards completely non-violent forms of nutrition. And we are on the earth here, on our way towards a completely non-violent form of nutrition. So there are lots of forms of evolution going on here. We see an evolution of our nutrition, which matches the evolution of our consciousness. It also matches the evolution of our organism. The more refined our organism becomes, which it does as the energy of feeling develops, the less we can tolerate animal food, food made from animal products. It's also a sexual evolution, which I won't go into now. But that's another long story. So one very important factor, Martinus says, in this evolution, the evolution of nutrition, is our sense of taste. Martinus says that our sense of taste hasn't been able to keep up with the rest of our evolution. And it's the task of our sense of taste to provide us with a natural sense of hunger and thirst. That means it should make us want substances that are actually good for us, that will promote our health and well-being. This sense of taste, however, has become distorted and very unreliable and gives us a desire for unnatural substances. And by that, Martinus means substances that are more or less indigestible, such as meat, where the extraction of the nutritional value causes too great a loss of energy. It takes a lot of energy to break down meat and get at the actual nutrition, which there is in meat. There is actually some nutrition in meat, but it's quite a violent process and tiring process to get at it. We also can desire substances that are far too strong for the organism. And here he mentions things like tobacco, alcohol, and drugs, all of which are vegan products. But they shake the body to its foundations, he said. He describes these substances as pure poison, and they inevitably lead to illness, sooner or later. So, Jamie Oliver, the English cook, said, and I'll leave out the swear words, he likes swear words, homicide is 0.8% of deaths. Diet-related disease is over 60%, but no one, bleep, 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 talks about it. But of course, many people are beginning to talk about it more and more, and here are listed some of the prominent names at the moment. There are many more, but from the United States, there's T. Colin Campbell and Michael Greggers, Dean Ornish, Caldwell Esselstyn, who's just been in Denmark and gave a lecture on diet and heart patients. Vicento Molina from Canada, who was in Denmark last summer at the Danish Vegetarian Festival. And in Denmark, we have Maria Felding and Matthias Schmidt-Hansen, who have written a Danish book on a plant-based diet, which is based on the newest research. So Jamie Oliver says no one's talking about it, but actually more and more people are talking about it. It's becoming a very hot subject. And of course the whole climate debate has promoted a lot of talk about this. Martinus writes, from a cosmic point of view, only a very small percentage of people within civilization are absolutely healthy. Only a very small percentage of people within civilization. So it's not very many people. And of course, other factors play a role, like fresh air, exercise, climate, light, hygiene, clothing, good housing, and so on. One of the reasons for this loss of our instinctive sense of taste, this reliable sense of taste, is this degeneration of the energy of instinct. Martinus explains in this symbol, where we see the evolution from the plant kingdom here to the animal kingdom, to the real human kingdom, and the higher spiritual realms, where we are in the second half of the animal kingdom here. And here you see the various quantities of these basic energies that I mentioned before. You see the different quantities in our consciousness. So we see, for example, in the plant, that instinct is dominating. So that means that the plant reacts instinctively. It doesn't have to think. And in the animal kingdom proper, in the real animals, then instinct is decreasing, but it's still fairly strong. So the animals are very good at finding the food that's right for them. They don't make mistakes, as I understand. Maybe if they're too much in contact with humans, I don't know. But what is happening with us is that our instinct is degenerating very much, and we're about this stage, which means that we can be attracted to alcohol and drugs and good vegan products like whiskey and chips and so on. So we're at a stage where we can't rely on our instinct, also in other areas of our life, but certainly in the nutritional field. But what's happening is that intelligence is growing, but we haven't got that far. And here we see the development of the science of nutrition. But as I've already pointed out, the experts don't agree. Some say, so you want to be vegan, you want to commit suicide? And to quote Esselstyn, he said, there are two kinds of cardiologists, vegans and those who haven't read the literature. So you see opinions at really opposite ends of the spectrum. And until people really agree, then nutritional science is not absolute. It's not at an absolute stage yet, because there's a lot of disagreement. But there's a growing consensus that the only way forward for mankind's health, for animal welfare, for the climate, is to go vegetarian and vegan. So, and of course, when we make wrong choices, so-called wrong choices, they're not really wrong, they're choices based on ignorance. We do the best we can, according to the knowledge we have at the moment. Then we can get ill from the effects, and this can make us ill. And this can result in us taking medicine, but all medicine has side effects. And of course, you can solve that. You can take other kinds of medicine to combat those side effects. And you can end up with quite a cocktail of different medications, which is far from ideal. Martinus also sees the consequences of our nutritional choices in the perspective of reincarnation. If, for example, we take drugs and drink alcohol, we can destroy our ability to create a healthy mental and physical organism in future lives. This, in turn, creates suffering, which stimulates our longing to find our way back to the most perfect nutrition possible. So let's see here. In the Ideal Food, chapter 2, he says here, it's a complicated sentence, so hang in there. He talks about the consequences of these wrong choices or faulty choices. This catastrophe is admittedly terrible in itself and appears as the very strongest or most radical experience that exists. But on the other hand, because of its strong effect, it completely stops the undermining and thereby brings the individual back to normality, or what is natural. so that it will never use its so that it will use its will and power to ensure that it will never again, within its present spiral of evolution, depart from the normal or divine paths within the sphere of nutrition. He's talking about the present spiral of evolution. So we get to a stage where things are so bad that we will never go back to wrong nutrition. And when Martinus talks about nutrition, he talks about everything we consume. So he's also talking about alcohol and drugs and so on. And I remember when I first moved to Copenhagen in 88, I had a job working in a nursing home, and one of the residents there, she was suffering from atrophy of the brain, that's hjernesvin in Danish, from drinking in this life alone. And she couldn't do anything for herself. She couldn't feed herself, she couldn't walk, she couldn't, yeah. She was helpless, absolutely helpless. She could hardly speak, she sort of grunted. So she had lost most of her faculties from drinking in this life. So, and if you can imagine that you could have several incarnations of drinking yourself into the ground, or taking drugs and so on, you get to a point of absolute helplessness, where you're motivated to use your will and all the power and energy that you have to ensure that you'll never go back to that state. It's so terrible. So, of course, it seems to be something we have to go through. And in chapter 4 of The Ideal Food, Martinus expresses why he wrote this book. He said, "I present these analyses because for mankind, the question of nutrition is so serious that none of its individuals can become truly healthy or have an existence that is truly free of illness before it comes into contact with a source of nutrition that, absolutely without being based on murder and dismemberment, and in accordance with eternal laws, is suited to the advanced human being's step in evolution." So, it's a question I'll come back to. We're talking about the ideal food, but you can ask about the ideal food for whom or what. Is the food that we're eating now suitable for us at our present state of evolution, or is it pulling us back, so to speak? So let's have a look at the evolution of nutrition on the Earth. According to Martinus, eating animals involves not only killing and dismembering animals, but it also undermines our health to an enormous extent. He actually describes it as a form of suicide, which is a very strong expression. But nonetheless, he feels obliged to give us these analyses. He describes the way we eat and drink at the moment as a kind of slow suicide. And of course, we are rather familiar with the appalling statistics for so-called lifestyle-related illnesses such as heart disease, cancer, diabetes, and all sorts of other things. So the effect of eating animals can be seen on many levels. Martinus claims that everything we do, everything we send out, comes back to us sooner or later. And for this to make sense, we have to take into account the idea of reincarnation, which you'll hear a lot about during this week. This means that every thought, every action, whether it be positive or negative, comes back to us with the same quality that it was sent out. When we kill animals in order to eat them, it's not because we hate them. We cause them an untimely death. We rob them of many years of their life. And that leaves us open to an untimely death. We kill millions upon millions upon millions of animals every day in order to eat their meat. And the animals have often spent their entire lives in captivity. Martinus says in The Ideal Food, using animals as slaves only enslaves us. So if we are feeling trapped in life, we can perhaps ask ourselves, where am I trapping other living beings? And maybe it's not so obvious because you just go down to the supermarket and you buy the food you want. But behind that, there is a whole level of suffering, perhaps, if it's meat or fish you're buying. But perhaps I should really stress that Martinus is in no way intolerant towards meat eaters or fish eaters or people who eat dairy products. He himself was a dairyman. He just feels compelled to present these analyses, and he's not telling anyone what to do, but he's presenting the consequences of different ways of behaving, and we make our own choices. So I'm presenting these analyses, but there's no finger wagging in it. But Martinus felt it was such an important subject, both for the animals, for ourselves, for our health, and so on. Some people object that if we didn't eat the animals, the earth would be overpopulated with them. But of course, if we stopped artificially inseminating animals, there would be far fewer of them. And of course, artificial insemination is in a way an abomination, because you rob the animals of the only real pleasure there is in the animal kingdom, and that's the act of mating. So instead they get a big rubber glove stuck up a certain place, and what fun is that? And for example, cows are kept almost constantly pregnant and they get totally worn out. So the number of animals on the earth would be controlled by the atmosphere of the earth itself. Martinus regards the earth itself as a living being. It has its own will, which would control the number of animals, and it would also be controlled by the resources on the planet, if only human beings would stop interfering and stop all this animal farming. Others are concerned that if we stopped eating meat and fish, it would create massive unemployment and it would ruin the economy of most countries which are based on these products. Martinus visited Iceland quite a few times, and in 1952 he spoke to the Icelandic president, who was very interested in Martinus's ideas. He was very sympathetic to his ideas, but he was rather worried about this vegetarianism. And he said the Icelandic people can't become vegetarian because we're a fishing nation. The fishing is the basis for our economy. And Martinus reassured him and said not to worry, because evolution moves slowly. So there will be plenty of time for all the various countries in the world to adapt to new ways of production, finding new food sources. And we see in Denmark at the moment, people are talking about changing the use of the fields. So I think, I'm not sure about the statistics, but I think about 80% of the crops that we grow in Denmark are used to feed animals. So that's a lot. So there's a lot of discussion about how to use, how to make a sustainable, how to create sustainable agriculture. So anyway, Martinus said nothing. Evolution doesn't go in leaps and bounds. It goes slowly and naturally. So countries and economies will have time to adapt. So to go back to our sense of taste, which Martinus keeps coming back to in this little book, he says that in order to be truly healthy and to live with respect for the animals, we need to re-educate our sense of taste. This can be quite a challenge if we're used to eating animal-based meals and alcohol and so on, and vegetarian food can taste really boring if that's what you're used to. but it's just a question of time. And in October, I was at the World Veg Festival in San Francisco, where I spoke about the ideal food. And there was a doctor there, Dr. Goldhammer, I think he was. He has a clinic where he helped people improve their health by having by fasting under medical control for quite an extensive period. And he described a patient who arrived at the beginning of his cure, and he was extremely obese and had all sorts of health problems. And he was presented with this vegan meal, and he thought it was totally disgusting. He'd never tasted anything like it. It was really horrible. And then he was put on this fast for quite a number of weeks. And then he was allowed to start eating again, but then it had to be vegan if he was going to follow this doctor's regime. And when he got this meal, and he said to the doctor, "Oh, it's really got good. You've got a new cook because the food's much better." But it was the same cook and more or less the same food as he'd had the first time. But what had changed was his sense of taste. And I remember, too, myself, I had a very good friend who had cancer a long time ago, and he had to follow a very strict diet with no milk products, no eggs, and certain vegetables were limited. So his wife and I went on the same diet to support him, just to make things easy. We worked together and ate together and so on. And after he died, then I thought, well, now I can go out and eat a dish with eggs and cheese and so on. It tasted disgusting because I hadn't eaten eggs and cheese for like 2 years. So my sense of taste had changed. And I was brought up as a Catholic. And as a little girl, we used to fast for 6 weeks up to Easter. And we used to have to sacrifice something. And I remember I didn't have any sugar for 6 weeks. And I was really looking forward to Easter Saturday, and I could eat all the sugar I wanted. It tasted horrible. It's like, so don't despair. If you want to change from eating meat and fish to becoming more vegetarian, your sense of taste will change. It'll catch up. So there's hope. Another thing is that we can have a lot of we can suffer a lot of pressure and ridicule from those around us, like family, friends, and people at our work who can say we're ridiculous for wanting to be vegetarian. And as I've already pointed out, even the official health advice and propaganda can be against you. However, suffering is a great motivator. If you've become ill from your eating habits, you will be very motivated to changing your way of life. So, suffering is a great motivator for many. It's a greater motivator than theory, but the theory can give you support to stick to your new lifestyle. Another sign that the sense of taste is unreliable is overeating. When we eat, and I emphasize we, when we eat more than we need, it's because our senses are not telling us we've had enough. And Martinus says in The Ideal Food that it's very rare to see people over the age of 40 who are slim. So this faulty sense of taste has a lot to answer for. Martinus talks about three kinds of heredity. We have one kind of heredity from our mothers, and one from our fathers, but we also have one from ourselves. And that's, in a way, the most important one. And you can perhaps, that can sound strange, but you inherit your own past from your previous lives. We have had many, many lives before this one. You'll hear more about reincarnation during the week, so I won't go into that, but it's our own past, our own positive and negative talents that we inherit from the past. So if you see, for example, a little girl who's extremely obese, and you see that she has obese parents, you can think, oh, what a pity, those parents are giving that child this food and so on, and it's all the parents' fault and so on. And of course, it is a tragedy for the child, but she has incarnated with those parents in order to get the genes and the environment, the social environment that she needs to manifest her own talents. So it's not just the father and the mother, it's also herself. Of course, she needs help like everybody else to get out of it, but it's not as simple as it looks sometimes. So, and of course, it can be easier to get up out of your habits if they arose in this life, but it's more of an uphill struggle if they arose in previous lives, because the habits are so ingrained. Let's go on. So, Martinus calls this symbol the principle of life units. And if we take it to be a human being, it could be me. This is my I, the innermost core of my being. This is my ability to experience life and to create. And this is my organism, which in turn consists of organs. Here we see 8 organs symbolized. The number is just symbolic. And they, again, are living beings. They're not just alive. They are actually living beings that have an eye, and an ability to experience and create, and an organism. And these organs, in turn, are made up of cells who have the same structure, and the cells are made up of smaller particles that have the same structure, and so on for all eternity, downwards and downwards, downwards into smaller and smaller particles. And if we go the other way and say, well, I am one of these, the smallest one, I live on the Earth, which is this one, which is a living being within the solar system, which is this one, which is a living being within the Milky Way, and so on, upwards for all eternity. And Martinus also calls this symbol the first glimpse of the Godhead, because this is how God is built up. It's life within life within life within life. So there is nothing outside of this. Everything is life. So, of course, it's easy to understand that we have an eye and an ability to create an experience and an organism and consciousness. But the same is true for a cow or a pig or a fish. They also experience life. They have an ability to experience that. They have an ability to create. Another point in this, if we now say it's a cow or a fish, you could say that the organs of the animal are alive. They're living beings in themselves. So if you're going to eat an animal, then you have to kill the animal itself in order to consume it. But then you have to kill the animal's organs, which are also, in a way, independent living beings, even though they live in the animal. And then you have to kill the cells that live in the animal. And then you have to kill the molecules that live in the animal cells. So there's a lot of killing on many levels. Of course, the same is true for plants, but plants have another sensory structure, which I'll come back to. So here we see the evolution of human nutrition. We see various stages. It's called the human being and animal and vegetable food. We see various stages in evolution. We see these large steps. This is the animal kingdom proper. This is the terrestrial human part of the animal kingdom. This is the real human kingdom. And these are high spiritual worlds. And here we see 3 forms of nutrition. Here we see what we call life units. So what we saw before in the previous symbol was the principle of life units, life within life within life within life. So here we have one life unit within a piece of meat. So this life unit has an eye, an ability to experience and create, and an organism and consciousness. And we see here 3 rings. The red ring is the actual nutrition in the meat. The yellow and green are the parts that have to be broken down, killed, in order to get access to the actual nutrition. And this is what takes energy to break all this down. And this is what leaves the body as excrement, afføring in Danish. In the idea of food, he also calls these life units, he calls them A life units, and the ones that we are at the actual nutrition, B life units. And here we can see he's separated them out. Here we have the A life units, the green and yellow ones, that have to leave the body as excrement, and here we have the red ones gathered in the middle. But they're not actually like that. They're sort of muddled together, mixed together. And here we see a very strong vibration, this zigzag. It means that the meat offers a lot of resistance when we want to digest it. This sun is shining, but it's orange, which means the killing principle, which means that the killing principle is part of the love of the universe, so to speak. It is a sun that's shining because we need to experience the culmination of darkness, and meat eating is part of that. So, in a cosmic perspective, it is a divine stage which nobody misses out on. If we go further up, we see our present stage. We are part animals and part human. We are the solution to the riddle of the Sphinx. And here we see a plant life unit. And we see, again, the eye and the ability to experience and create. And we see this organism, which is red, which means it's only these B life units, the life units that we can actually digest, the real nutrition. And there's a little black line around them, but that's the resistance offered, for example, by the skin of an apple or something. There's a little bit to break down, but not much. Nothing that involves killing. And we see that this has a gentler vibration, more suited to the human vibration. He has two explanations of this figure. In one explanation, he says it's the vibration of the human organism, and he says in that connection that this kind of food is far too strong for us. It shakes our body to the foundations. The ideal food for us at the moment is rather coarse vegetarian food, like rice and potatoes and root vegetables and all sorts of green vegetables and nuts and seeds and so on, combined with fruit. And fruit is the other explanation he gives for this figure. So the ideal food for us at our present stage of evolution is this mixture of vegetables, pulses, seeds, and fruit. And as we evolve, we'll get to a stage where we can live on fruit alone. And again, it's only B life units, that can be absorbed without any kind of resistance and that don't actually die in our organism. If you eat a strawberry, for example, it remains alive all the way through us, so it doesn't actually die. And here we see this killing process. We see how the yellow and green life units are distorted and mottled. They're being digested and destroyed by the gastric juices, where here there's harmony. So, to sum up, so if we look at make a summary of the principle of nutrition, you can say that in the plant kingdom, the plants get their nutrition by sucking water from the ground. There's also photosynthesis, but it's a very peaceful, non-violent way of feeding yourself. And we go further on in the plant kingdom. Here we have a Venus flytrap. And this is the beginning of a violent way of eating, where the flytrap has evolved a way of sensing an insect coming in here, and then it can close itself on it, and there's some sticky juice in there that can begin to digest the insects. So these are carnivorous plants or insectivorous plants. And this is another way of doing it, where this carnivorous plant has a pitcher with some liquid at the bottom, and it's got a clever mechanism at the top. So when it senses this insect going into the pitcher, it closes down on it, and the insect can't get out, and it gets digested. So this is the beginning of an animal digestive system. I should add that, we get to the animals now. Then we go on to the real animals, and here we see the ideal food for a lion. Here we see a way of feeding oneself that is based entirely on killing. Kill or be killed. That's the rule of life in the animal kingdom. And of course, this is the ideal food for a lion. If you try to feed a lion on apples and carrots, you would have a serious problem. He would probably eat you rather than the apples or carrots. In a sense, most of mankind still eats like this. And we can ask, is this standard of nutrition good enough for the evolved human being? And this is the ideal food for a polar bear. All animals also go through an epoch of being vegetarians. Some become vegetarians first and then meat eaters, and some do it the other way around. And here we have the human version of it. Here we prefer it neatly packed and nicely presented. But in principle, it's the same. We're just getting someone else to do the killing for us. So I put out the question, is this the ideal food for mankind now? Are we still at the level of the beasts of prey? Martinus says not, that we will get ill from this, and we will suffer many consequences from killing the animals and the fish. So this is the ideal food for us now. It's a plant-based diet consisting of grains, nuts, seeds, beans, vegetables, and fruit. This is the ideal food for mankind at the moment. And of course, there's a lot of individual needs. I see a lot of things here that I'm allergic to. So Martinus describes people, he puts people into two categories, present patients and the future patients. And some of us are present patients. I'm certainly an allergy sufferer. So a lot of good vegetables and fruit I can't eat. But this is what he sees as the ideal food for us now. And this is the future. Fruitarianism. This is not now. Our digestive system needs the roughage, the fiber that we can get from the vegetables in order to live a healthy life. And of course, we need air, which is a very important source of nutrition. You can't live many seconds without air. So in conclusion, Martinus gives some hints to the vegetarian beginner. He says, keep it simple. He didn't think strong spices were a good idea. You can imagine them burning the microcosmos. He recommends not having big dinners, not too many courses, no alcohol, one or two glasses of water or fruit juice at a meal. No frying, he says, and he said this in 1933, which I think was long before medical science began to discover that there were really problems with eating things that were fried. He says that milk is fine for the vegetarian beginner, but he says healthy milk, and you can ask yourself today, how healthy is the milk? And for the interpreters, I have a quote here from the Ideal Food, chapter 28. He says, every individual must keep strictly to the foods that cause him no trouble and whose digestion he, so to speak, doesn't notice. So if we feel uncomfortable, if something is wrong, then it's a sign that we're on the wrong track. So veganism is the future. as I said before, a lot of people go directly, especially the young people today, they go directly from meat eating to veganism. Many transition through dairy products. You can maybe eat dairy products for some years or some lives. That's up to you. You decide for yourself the tempo. So, if you want to read some more about these things, here are some references. I would really recommend The Ideal Food. It's available in a lot of languages. And the last time I looked at, I haven't looked at the statistics recently, but it's the book we have sold the most of from the Martinus Institute in all languages. It's certainly the most we have sold in English. So, I think that's what I had to say. So, happy reading.